welcome to All-Star Wrestling. Vince McMahon here at ringside, along with wrestling's living legend, Bruno Sammartino. This week on the card, here on All-Star Wrestling, Bruno will take a look at the thus far undefeated Hulk Hogan.
Undefeated, and wonder who's going to stop this man. He's so big, so colossal, strong. So far, he's had no trouble with anybody he's met.
Also on the card this week, ladies and gentlemen, the Olympian, Ken Patera.
Well, Patera is now the Intercontinental Champion. It's going to be interesting to see who's going to take this title away from Patera. He's so tough that it's going to be, he may have this title for years to come.
Ken Patera competing in the non-title event. We'll also see, ladies and gentlemen, on the card this week, Torquemada. As Torquemada meets Rene Goulet.
Tough bout, but because of the karate, the judo, the everything together, I'm going to have to pick Kamada, but it's going to be an interesting bout, I think.
We'll also see Bob Backlund in our very special feature presentation. Bob Backlund in an exhibition match, a non-title exhibition match. Bob Backlund will meet El Olimpico. So we shall return with those matches and more when we continue in a moment. Ken Patera, assisted by the Grand Wizard of Wrestling. And Patera is something else indeed, an extraordinarily gifted athlete. But then again, even though he has those gifts, he does work hard at his trade. Patera in the gym every day. It's one thing, Bruno, to have your God-given talents. It's another thing to really develop those talents. And that's what Ken Patera has done.
No question about it. I don't like Patera simply because he has so much talent, and yet he's one of the worst rule breakers. For that, I resent him and dislike him very, very much. But as far as...
Oh, Patera really going to work on Steve. Oh, my. What a slam, an elbow. Ken Patera with Steve King has him up again with just with such tremendous ease. Slams him to the canvas, another elbow. Ken Patera showing no mercy at all on Steve King. Whips him to the ropes, waiting for him. Back body drop. It's all Ken Patera. Patera with Steve King. Suplexing him. Patera just toying around with Steve King. Whips him now, and that's swinging for Nelson. That neck breaker. And Patera still hanging on with that neck breaker. He loves it. This is Ken Patera. He loves to grind it out. He has God-given talents, all right. Talents that he has developed. But you can't say much for this man's disposition. You can't say much for his tactics in the ring.
Ladies and gentlemen, the time is a new record here on All-Star Wrestling. In just 43 seconds, your winner, Ken Patera.
Well, that is unbelievable. Ken Patera establishing a new record here on All-Star Wrestling. 43 seconds. Is all it took him to defeat Steve King. Just 43 seconds, Bruno, that's phenomenal.
Well, it certainly is. He came in on him and he just gave him some unbelievably ferocious body slams, and just King just never had a chance. You say 43 seconds, I think he was able to beat him in about 10 seconds if he had chosen just to cover him after one of those horrible, horrible body slams he gave him.
And unfortunately for Steve King, he is leaving the ring. Much like many others have left the ring, having faced Ken Patera on a stretcher with no doubt a neck injury of some kind. To what extent he is injured, we'll await a report. But Patera delights in, well, no one can use that hold like Ken Patera.
Well, that's why I dislike the man so much. We were talking about his God-given talent, and certainly has had an abundance of talent, strength, speed, wrestling skills. He has everything. And yet to be such a vicious, vicious man in that ring, to break the rules as he does, it's really disgraceful, because, and also extremely dangerous for any opponent, because he's got so much, and on top of it all, he's so extremely vicious. There was no need for him to hurt King the way he has. No reason for it at all.
Unfortunate for Steve King, leaving the ring in this fashion. We shall return, ladies and gentlemen.
Professional 10-minute exhibition match. Introducing in the corner to my right, from Mexico City, Mexico, 230 pounds, El Olimpico. And his opponent from Princeton, Minnesota, 239 pounds. He is the current World Wrestling Federation heavyweight champion, Bob Backlund.
Bob Backlund, the World Wrestling Federation champion. This is a non-title event, of course. A special exhibition. We're going to have 10 minutes of wrestling exhibition non-stop. Regardless of if Backlund pins Olimpico five or six times during the course of that 10 minutes, or the other way around, we're going to have 10 minutes of wrestling action. Bob Backlund against El Olimpico should be a scientific type match. Olimpico, very good wrestler. Here we go. Backlund behind Olimpico now. What do you look for here, Bruno, in this match?
Well, you know, this is, as you said, it's going to be strictly scientific. It's going to be just moves, holds, counter holds, escapes. And, of course, you know, Olimpico is a very talented wrestler. There's no question about it. But, of course, he's in there against Backlund, who is the world champion, you know, which tells you that he definitely is the better man. And what Backlund will do is demonstrate some holds on Olimpico and have a nice little workout to show people a little bit about how to apply holds, how to escape holds. That's really what it's about, and that's what Backlund's going to display here.
Backlund quickly behind Olimpico. And Backlund with a very nice takedown. And perhaps could have pinned him there. A little handshake, they'll start all over.
Now, when Backlund got behind Olimpico and he took him over, took him back, Backlund could have easily stayed almost in a bridge position and he could have pinned Olimpico, but he's not looking for a pin. I think, again, this is a little exhibition where he's just going to give a demonstration of holds and counter holds and so forth. And but, you know, so I wonder, I don't think people are looking or they understand that this isn't a contest as to somebody trying to beat anybody. I mean, at least I know Backlund's not going to try to beat Olimpico.
Oh, no, of course not. It is, however, I feel, even though we've seen several times here where Backlund had submission holds, or certainly painful holds, that could have been submission, perhaps. Backlund released the hold.
Which, well, exactly.
I think, though, in a match like this, if I could put myself in Olimpico's shoes, even though it's an exhibition match, if Olimpico really gives a good accounting of himself here, I think that it, you know, pushes him up in the ratings, doesn't it?
I know exactly what you're saying. You're absolutely right. If Olimpico can make some good moves and look good against Backlund over here, you can bet you that many promoters and people will be watching this thing will be looking at Olimpico, you know, with a lot more carefully and wanting him in arenas with bigger and better opponents than perhaps he's been facing up to now, because making a good showing against the world champion is a tremendous boost to anyone.
Abaca now, who had a pinning combination there, releases the hold, they'll start all over.
Kick him in the ball!
Limico with all kind of experience. Nice take. No, he didn't quite get him down yet. Now, that's a tough thing to do, I would think, when you're up there like that on one leg, Bruno. What do you do? And, I mean, you're really off balance.
Well, Backlund right now is bracing himself, using leverage here, and he's going to probably shoot up and go behind, take him into a monkey flip. But Olympic, on the other hand, was not using much. He wasn't making his widest move because when he hooked one of Backlund's leg, he should have immediately moved in and tried to trip up the other one. Of course, Backlund's very quick, and he's got tremendous speed and agility. He could have probably ducked away from it, but the point is, Olympico, that was an opening for him that he passed.
Well, nice. Okay, nice take. No, did he get him? No, not quite. Almost. Olympico, that was really wouldn't have been classified as a takedown on the part of Olympico, would it, bro?
No, because Backlund had only touched the mat, and he pulled a reverse, and he switched, and he got right behind Olympico. So if it was amateur, if you were to judge it, it would have been Backlund that would have scored the 2 points and not Olympico.
And Backlund over there next to the rope. He shot the half there, released it, and all there back up in the standing position. I hope the fans really are enjoying this as much as we are, because this is, you know, scientific wrestling, and you know, you get really have an appreciation of what it's all about.
I think the fans do. You won't hear a lot of booing and cheering, naturally, because they realize what they're seeing. They're seeing an exhibition of wrestling holds. Again, as we said, to holds and escapes and counter holds and so forth. And I think they're watching and enjoying it and appreciating it very much, I'm sure.
Olympico up now, and Backlund. Ooh, wow, that's smart. Suplex. Backlund could cover him for a pin if he wanted to. Almost instinctively there, you know, and you do so much, I would think, Bruno, as I've watched you in the squared circle, and I can remember that night when you were wrestling with a broken neck. You suffered a broken neck during the match and continued to wrestle. And yeah, I, of course, no one knew it at the time, but you wrestle on instinct many, many times, do you not? I mean, that's the point I'm making. That.
I think you're referring to what Backlund did here a second ago. When he took Olympico with a suplex, he almost covered him, but then he did not. Instinct, automatically, you get your opponent down and you're going to go for that pin or for the submission or whatever, but then you catch yourself in that split second like Backlund did, because he's certainly not out here to try and pin Olympico. But he will make he might go towards the move, but then realize what he's doing and back off. And because, as you say, instinct, when you're in that ring and you get your man, you know, in a position, you're going to go for that pin or submission. So it's instinct, as you say. And as far as wrestling with my broken neck, I think if somebody told me I had a broken neck at the time, I probably would have fainted right on the spot, but I didn't know.
I doubt that very seriously. Olympico, I think, was going to, looked like maybe he was going to let him have it.
Looked like he was going to give a blow. I don't know if it was a fist or forearm blow, but he saw immediately that Backlund already had a counter for it, as Backlund brought his own left up to block it. And Olympico,
threw the shot.
I'm surprised at Olympico. I'm disappointed.
Open, that's okay. It was the open hand, and it wasn't the clinched fist, I don't believe. Open hand, so what the heck is legal, you know? Backlund wrapping him up now. Ooh, my. Well, this is sort of developing into more of a match, actually, than an exhibition now. Olympico from Mexico City, and he's back on just so quick, isn't he, Bruno?
He got behind Olympico at the time. Olympico didn't even know it had happened so fast. He just didn't know it all. It was tremendous, tremendous speed, tremendous agility, and that's why he's the world champion. He's got so much going for him. Great speed, knows the game inside out, stamina galore, strong. I mean, you know, that's the making of a world champion.
Olympico, what is Backlund doing here? I'll get another suplex. And again, Backlund, as we said before, instinctively covering his man. Olympico was one of the finest, although he doesn't spend much time at all in Mexico, as we understand now, but he's credited as being one of the finest wrestlers ever in his home country,
he did extremely well in Mexico, and then that's why he came over here, because he thought for, you know, how good he was over there and for defeating most all opposition, he wanted to try his hand at coming here, the World Wrestling Federation, because this has a reputation of having the toughest and finest wrestlers in the world. So he wanted to try his hands against the best wrestlers that exist in the world, which are over here.
Olympico up, and Backlund could give him that atomic knee drop if he wants. I don't think he will. Olympico desperately grabbing the rope. Olympico was going to fire off the rope, trying to do a little something here to make a good accounting of himself against Backlund. Backlund takes him down again, leg dive. Interesting situation here. You think Backlund's trying to get him over for a Boston Crab?
Well, if he is, it'll be a little hard because Olympico did hook Backlund's right leg. And of course, you know, if you hook his right leg, it's going to prevent him from spinning to take him over. Anyway, I think the people appreciated this very much.
Definitely appreciated it. Backlund, El Olympico, in the exhibition match. Backlund raising the hand of El Olympico. I enjoyed that. I really did. We shall return, ladies and gentlemen, as we continue in just a moment with an interview.
Championship Wrestling appears in Madison Square Garden. Scheduled to compete on the wrestling event will be Baron Mikel Cicluna squaring off against Gargantuan Gorilla Monsoon. We shall also see on the wrestling event this Monday night the individual matchup between Dominic DiNucci and Larry Zbyszko. From there, a special six-man tag team match will be headed your way when the three Samoans, AFA, Sika, the World Wrestling Federation Tag Team Champion, is joining up with the high paramount Samoan chief, Peter Maivia. Those three competing against Mr. USA, Tony Atlas, Ivan Putski, the Polish power, and Pat Patterson. And then from there, in the Texas death match, no holds barred confrontation, Bob Backlund, hopeful of successfully defending the World Wrestling Federation title against the Olympian Ken Patera. And all of this in addition to the 16-man over-the-top rope battle royal, over-the-top rope being the process of elimination until one very fortunate individual will collect $15,000 this Monday night. So with that in mind, let's bring on the largest participant in this battle royal, a man who perhaps has won more battle royals than anyone else participating in this battle royal this Monday night. To my left, Gorilla Monsoon.
You know, Vince, I'm looking forward to that battle royal. That 15 grand can go a long way and do a lot of things. I'm really looking forward to it. I'm not looking forward to stepping in the ring with Cicluna because he's a roughneck, probably one of the roughest raw-bone individuals in professional wrestling, and he always seems to enter the ring with some kind of a hidden foreign object that I'm going to be looking for constantly out there because he can hurt you with that and really put you out of professional wrestling if you give him the opportunity. But my mind will definitely be on that $15,000. I'm making a trip to Rome this month, and I could use the money.
I'm sure, but then again, so could 15 other combatants in there. Mr. USA, Tony Atlas, Larry Zbyszko, just to name a few.
You know, this is going to be my first opportunity to get my hands on Larry Zbyszko since his confrontation with Bruno Sammartino. And I'm looking forward to that. There's nowhere he's going to be able to hide out there. He's going to have his hands full, Larry Zbyszko.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Gorilla Monsoon meeting individual competition this Monday night against Baron Mikel Cicluna, and then one of the 16 participants in the over-the-top rope battle royal. If we may now, let's bring on the World Wrestling Federation champion, Bob Backlund, to discuss the Texas death match, Bob, against Ken Patera.
Yes, I'm definitely going to have my hands full. He's got a lot of things going for himself right now. He's got that Intercontinental Championship. He beat a very good wrestler in that, in Pat Patterson. And now the momentum has turned, and he thinks, well, everybody's actually got him already winning the match, winning the title, but I'm going in there and I'm going to give it 100%. There's no way. I'm going to go in there and I'm not going to let myself, if I go in there and not give any less than 100%, I'm letting myself down and I'm letting all those fans out there. You've went too far with me. You've been behind me too much, and I'm not going to quit now. Ken Patera, I want you to know that I'm not quitting for nothing. And there's no rules in this, Vince. There's no stopping it. There's no stopping because of bloody noses, nothing. No count outs. There has to be a 1, 2, 3, or I quit. And I'm not quitting.
Bob Backlund with his views of the upcoming match, the Texas Death match, this Monday night in Madison Square Garden. And we may now let's bring on a champion in his own right. Let's bring on Ken Patera, the reigning Intercontinental Champion, along with his manager, the Grand Wizard. And Ken Patera, just about that far from perhaps becoming the World Wrestling Federation title holder.
That's right. You know, it's been eluding me for quite some time, Bobby Backlund. Well, I'm fed up with it. I didn't get here just by sitting on my behind. I've been out training, Bobby Backlund, not only my body, but my mind. Along with the Grand Wizard, you're seeing the greatest team in professional sports. Not only brilliant intelligence, but unbelievable strength and physiques. Now, Bobby Backlund, you're the champion, that's right. And maybe deserving so. But you're looking at a man that has accomplished everything on his own up until just a few short months ago when I finally formed with the Grand Wizard. We finally got it all together. And Bobby Backlund, we destroyed Pat Patterson just like that. And we're going to destroy you in a Texas Deathmatch rules just like that. So get ready and polish that belt, boy.
10 minutes.
Zbyszko having a few words with the referee. It seems like Larry Zbyszko just can't get along with anyone these days. Zbyszko easily taking over Angelo Gomez. Easy takedown. Obviously, Larry Zbyszko, the heavy favorite, almost the prohibitive favorite, actually, in this match against Angelo Gomez. Zbyszko, I think, enters the ring now with a different attitude altogether. He goes in with the attitude of arrogance, the likes of which I think we've never seen before in wrestling. He's changed. I mean, he's just a completely different individual. But Zbyszko claims he hasn't changed at all. He just has never had an opportunity to prove his skills. Claims he is the most misunderstood wrestler, perhaps in the history of pro wrestling. Again, more argument between Zbyszko and the referee. Zbyszko does not feel threatened at all. Doesn't feel threatened at all by Angelo Gomez. Gomez to the buckle. And Zbyszko looks pretty good, Bruno.
Vince, I'd rather not say how he looks because, you know, I'm so more disgusted, more frustrated, more bitter at this Judas than I've ever been before. And I don't see nothing good about him at all.
Zbyszko now with Angelo Gomez slamming him to the canvas. Thank you. Gomez throwing a few rights there. But just like that, Larry Zbyszko turns it right back around, and Angelo Gomez is high in the air, and Zbyszko suplexes him with no problem at all. Covers this man, gets two, and gets three. Now look at that. That is disgusting. Zbyszko throwing kisses to the fans. Certainly in a satirical way. Let's get the official time.
The time of the match, 3 minutes, 27 seconds, and your winner, Larry Zbyszko.
Larry Zbyszko on to victory, an easy victory for him over Angelo Gomez. Let's go back now and take a look at some slow motion action with Zbyszko. Zbyszko, who has perfected so many holds, he really has in his at his command really almost any hold in pro wrestling today. He could just do them all and do them all very, very well. This particular one we have seen Zbyszko use quite a bit of as of late, however. The suplex, and he just took Angelo Gomez up with no problem at all. All the way back, and just really that particular hold, of course, doing a lot of damage to the neck, doing a lot of damage to the upper back. And Zbyszko, very candidly, is not overly concerned with the damage he does to his opponents. I'm sure we'll be seeing more of Larry Zbyszko in the weeks to come.
Team match against
USA, Tony Atlas, Ivan Putski, and Pat Patterson. And it will be as well this Monday night when we see the spectacular 16-man over-the-top rope battle royal, the winner of which receives $15,000. But coming into view now, Ken Patera, accompanied by his manager, the Grand Wizard of Wrestling. And Ken Patera, with one title under your belt, here Ken Patera is reaching for the pinnacle, and perhaps a desperate effort on your part, because you'll never perhaps have another opportunity to become the World Wrestling Federation champion.
You know, the way I look at it, Bobby Backlund, is that I am definitely the better man. My credentials prove it. My ability has proven it. I've beaten on you on other occasions. In January, I came back and beat you in February, along with your geek Pat Patterson at the same time. And then I turned around because of you two geeks trying to insult me and beat Pat Patterson for the Intercontinental Championship. And now it's a Texas Death Match to see. Just to see who is the toughest. Not to see who's the best or who's the champion, but to prove who's the toughest. Texas Death Match rules, Bobby Backlund. You are the champion, right? Well, you are going to be a loser when I get through with you, boy, because you make me sick. Your apple pie, American flag, and mother make me sick.
Ken Patera, along with his manager, the Grand Wizard of Wrestling. We may now, let's bring on the champion, Bob Backlund, to discuss his participation in the main event this Monday night.
Normally, Vince, I don't really like Texas death matches. I don't think they should even be in professional wrestling. But when you got a man the likes of Ken Patera, you need something like that to decide it. And Ken Patera, if it's a Texas death match you want, it's a Texas death match you're going to get. If you don't want any rules, that's just the way it's going to be. And yes, we're going to find out just who the better man is in a Texas death match. No rules, no interference, no countouts, no stopping the match. Only one winner. That's the way I want it.
Bob Backlund competing against Ken Patera for the World Wrestling Federation title. No holds barred in the Texas death match this Monday night in Madison Square Garden.
Time limit, introducing in the corner to my right, from Charlotte, North Carolina, weighing 235 pounds, it is Rick McGraw. And his opponent from New York City, weighing 241 pounds, it is the unpredictable Johnny Rod.
Rick McGraw, last week, having a tough battle with Jose Estrada, he came out on the victorious side. And here we go with Johnny Rod. It's a very interesting match to start things off here on Championship Wrestling.
Following is brought to you by Capital Wrestling Corporation. Good seats are still available for this Monday's card of wrestling at Madison Square Garden. And it will be in the Garden this Monday when one man will leave the ring $15,000 richer as the winner of the 16-man over-the-top rope battle royal. The experts really have not been able to come up with the favorite in this affair, and it's my guess that everyone has a good shot to win the pie this Monday night in the Garden.
Rods again now in the middle of the ring, locking up with Rick McGraw.
You know, this McGraw, I don't know how long he's been wrestling, but he's pretty wise in there. I mean, the bout starts with Rods doing a couple little things that aren't exactly legal, and then he offers a shake hand. McGraw comes in with a beautiful drop kick, driving Rods against those buckles pretty hard, and then he turns right around and offers his hands to Rods, as if to say, go ahead, boys, guy, you're gonna be smart, I can play that game too. I like this guy, Vince. To look at him, you know that he trains hard. He's got a good-looking body to him, which tells you the amount of time he spends in the gymnasium. But he's a gutsy guy, she showed us before. He can be punished, but he's got that little bit extra that he can come back with, as he's doing right now. And I think he's a pretty doggone tough competitor. I think we're going to see quite a bit of this guy because he's got a lot to offer here.
McGraw back to the standing position. He's in there against a very cagey wrestler, Johnny Rods. Nice retaliation, forearm smash to the chest area. McGraw now with a side headlock. McGraw tightening his hold, and Rod's trying to power his way out of it. I doubt he'll be able to do it. But it looks like he's turning him. No, he's not. That's a tough thing to do, I would think, Bruno.
It is, unless you have you're a strong man like a Patera or somebody that's really got that super strength.
Or a San Martino.
You,
well,
thank you. Then you can, you know, but when you take two people that are just about even strength-wise, as I assume these two are, then it's very difficult.
Rod for the head scissor. McGraw kicks out. Right back up to a side headlock again. Rods has him up. Oh, nice maneuver by McGraw. Hair pull, head scissor. And also Rods hooking an arm just to make sure he has a little, oh, wait a minute, Worley. The referee, Dick Worley, breaking the hold up. Reversal. Rods attacking McGraw. McGraw distracted by the referee momentarily. A scoop. McGraw up, a slam by Johnny Rods. More momentum off the rope. Cover. No, can't quite get him. Not going to get Rods that easy. He is a tough customer. And McGraw tries what Rods was not successful at a moment ago. Johnny Rods making good use of the ropes. Missing with the elbow. Now a cover. Two. Nope. There we see the feet on the bottom rope there. Johnny Rods working the knee over. I suspect that is where this hold is most punishing, is it not, Bruno, the knee?
Right at the joint there, and that's a little bit of punishment on the ankle area, but it's on the knee. And that's very dangerous, of course, because you don't want to stretch on those ligaments too much because, all athletes, that's one of the places that they get hurt the most is the knees. And a lot of the wrestlers, of course, got this problem too. So that's a bad spot to be hooked on.
McGraw favoring that knee area at the moment now. Rods whipped to the ropes. McGraw waiting. No, telegraphed his maneuver. Johnny Rods picked it up quite nicely. Rods now on the attack. Into the side of the head, the elbow finding its mark. Rods now on the rope again. Off and no. Rods barely missing.
McGraw covers his man, gets two on him, that's all. McGraw right back.
Thus far, Vince, it's been a good moving match. Lots of action. Johnny started out by wrestling against McGraw. He found out that McGraw was a little bit sharper and was escaping most of the holds that Johnny was able to put on him. So Johnny then started getting involved with some rough tactics here, but he's finally got that McGraw can take it. Can take it and he can come back. And it's been a back and forth seesaw type bout, but it's certainly been an interesting one and a fast moving one.
McGraw whipped to the ropes, Rob's waiting for him, missing with the elbow, McGraw right back. Both Rods and McGraw tiring unquestionably. Roundhouse right misses. McGraw does quick left jab. Right hand finds its mark. Slugfest developing here. McGraw clipping Rods again. McGraw scoops the leg. Down goes Rods to cover. We get one, two, and that's all. Boy, that Johnny Rods is unpredictable, and he is a tough customer. So is Rick McGraw.
Well, last time we saw McGraw, Vince, he took on Estrada. It was a very tough bout, but he did come out on top. This week he's taking on Rods. I mean, his two appearances here thus far have been against pretty good tests for him, because he's taking on a couple of really rugged customers. If he can get past Rods, and that remains to be seen, then the people are going to have to start recognizing that the McGraw is a wrestler to be reckoned with.
McGraw has proven he can take a lot of punishment and still come back at you, but just how much, I think we're going to find out this week, because Rods is pouring it on. Rods not letting up at all. Rick McGraw in his second appearance here in the World Wrestling Federation. You saw that right hand really land across the chin of Rick McGraw. McGraw now whipped to the buckle. Rods coming in after him. And McGraw follow through with an elbow. A cover. No, he won't get him. McGraw frustrated, as you might suspect he would.
I think had it not been for those ropes, we would have seen a pin, because Rods was hurt. I mean, after McGraw ducked out of that corner, Rods really hit it hard with his head. Then he got hit with an elbow. Beautiful drop kick.
Beautiful drop kick. Up again, though. Rods on the rope. Lands on the head of Rick McGraw. McGraw to the ropes, whipped to the far side, and Rods waiting for it. Flying body press. He'll get it. Competitor on this given occasion, not quite as tough as Rick McGraw.
It is the time, 8 minutes and 19 seconds. The winner, Rick McGraw.
Rick McGraw victorious. I think we're going to have him around here at the World Wrestling Federation for a while. Let's go back, Bruno, and take a look at some slow motion action.
Well, over here we see, I believe this is where Rods whips McGraw to the rope, and I believe that this is where McGraw comes in with a beautiful flying, here we go, body press. And there it is, just beautifully executed, driving Rods down and holding him for the count of three.
We shall return, ladies and gentlemen, with our next match in a moment.
So, Martino.
You know, last week, Vince, we showed again part of the match with Zbyszko. And everybody saw what this rat did, how he ran like a rat. And what's even more frustrating for me now, more frustrated and bitter than I've ever been, is the fact that he's gotten away with it. And thus far, I've contacted everybody imaginable trying to get this man trapped into another match. Even the president of Worldwide Wrestling Federation, who resides in Japan. And thus far, I've been turned down. But they may turn me down, but I'll be pounding on more doors. Before this thing is over, I'm going to get Zbyszko, because there's nothing else that matters to me in my wrestling career, in my future, until I get this Judas. And I will not stop at anything. If I have to beg, if I have to go to Japan, whatever I have to do. But the fans have not heard of this, the end of this. No way he could have kicked out of it.
Ken Patera. We shall return, ladies and gentlemen, as we continue in just a moment.
Here is the World Wrestling Federation.
the Samoans, the tag team champions of the World Wrestling Federation in a non-title event. There's no doubt we'll see very little in the way of scientific knowledge and displayed here in this match. Here we go.
Following is commercial in nature. The beautiful Menin Arena of Morristown, New Jersey will be the setting 1 week from tonight for an all-star match spectacular second to none. Seeing action on the card will be Mr. Pat Patterson. Mr. Patterson, every day, gets more and more fans supporting him and his exploits in the World Wrestling Federation. And Pat Patterson, indeed, looking forward to seeing these fans 1 week from tonight when professional wrestling indeed comes to Morristown, New Jersey's Menin Arena.
A close-up view of Albano's face, Bruno. It seems to me that I don't know what he has done to it.
There isn't much more you could do to it, is there?
I don't know, but I think he's found some sort of way. As now the Samoans double-team Rene Goulet. Triple-team.
Well, what they did, first they got Gomez out of there, and now they've been on Goulet. Goulet, of course, is the more experienced and the tougher of the two. Ah, here we go.
Turning things round on the Samoan. Gomez back in with a side headlock, not for long. Leapfrog, Samoan turns around, drop kick. Backs the Samoan up a bit, but that's about all. Shoulder block. Gomez backs himself up. There's Albano. Looks like Albano's like he has rings of some kind in his face.
Yeah, now how in the world do you get those in there? I mean, they're pinned onto his face. Well, I guess they have to put a little hole around his cheeks?
Oh, there, you can see that he has... Oh, look, you can even see the bruise. I think he's a little softer than we actually thought he was, Bruno.
Oh, I never had any doubt, Vince. Oh,
well, I had some, I must admit, but I think he's taken that one step beyond.
What you're saying is he's beyond, what is it, the point of no return. That's what I'm trying to say.
I think he crossed over that fine line. But you can't knock him in terms of tag team championship combinations are concerned. He has managed now, this makes the ninth tag team championship combination.
Well, he certainly has the record. He's had more tag team champions than any manager in the history of wrestling. And in these two, the two Samoans, they may, let's hope not, but they may be around quite some time with these titles.
Whip to the ropes. Afa lifts him really high with a back body drop. Yeah, you look at the Samoans, and I wouldn't be surprised that the Samoans didn't influence Lou Albano with putting those rings through his face. It wouldn't shock me to see one of these Samoans come out with a ring in his through his nostrils or something.
Yeah, I was going to say, he's got two in his cheeks. He should have one in his nose now. Well, he doesn't seem concerned. I mean, Goulet is a very fine wrestler and a veteran who's been around a long time. But in Gomez here, we have a younger fellow who really has not been around all that much, not all that experienced. He's not all that big in size. So the Samoans, you know, shouldn't have too bad of a time. And Albano knows this.
Sika in there now against certainly the more inexperienced Angelo Gomez. Oh, Goulet coming after Albano. Got a shot in there. Knocked the fat man down. Tag is made, and now Afa comes through, taking over on Angelo Gomez.
Look at the hair of Lou Albano. What is that, the mange? What is that?
I don't know. It looks like all of a sudden he's gone gray on the sides there. Looks gray to me, is it? Or is it blonde?
Gomez having no effect on Apa. There's that goofy Lou Albano. Look at him. Boy, one look at that face. And you know, just like the old saying, a picture's worth a thousand words.
What you're saying, he and the Samoans kind of belong together, huh?
There's no doubt there is a threesome there. Here we go. We're likely to see the Samoan drop now. No escape for young Angelo Gomez. Two. It's over. Gallet coming in to kick Samoan. But the count is official. All righty, the Samoans chalk up a victory for themselves here on Championship Wrestling in the non-title event. Let's get the official time.
It is time to fall. 42 seconds. The winners are the World Wrestling Federation Tag Team Champions, the Samoans.
Samoans victorious. Let's take a look at some slow motion action, Bruno.
Well, we pick it up right where the Samoan had grabbed Gomez and gave him the Samoan drop. But they had punished him quite a bit through the bout, and of course, this was the final thing.
And now let's take one more look if we still have it. There's that whatever you want to call him, manager, Lou Albano. There he is. Now, that is the look of what?
That's the look of a sick man, a mentally sick man.